2 bays or 4? I mean, it seems like a pretty simple choice, right? How many drives do you want to put in a box, and that's how many bays you need. But it's not quite that simple, and there can often be a number of differences between 2 and 4 bay units, and a number of other things you might want to consider before buying, so let me run you through them. Now, a quick refresher for those who don't know, a NAS is a network attached storage device. Basically, it's a standalone little computer that you put storage drives inside, and it connects those storage drives to your network or your local area network or LAN so that you can access those files without having to directly plug it in like a direct attached storage device like a USB hard drive. In general, you want at least 2 drives in your NAS, hence why this is a 2 bay unit. And the reason for that is you want to set up this unit in what's called RAID 1. RAID stands for Redundant Array of Inexpensive Disks, and RAID 1 is the mode or the type of RAID where all of your data gets stored or mirrored to the second drive. So it's a one-to-one copy, which means that either one of those drives can fail, and when you replace it, it will be able to rebuild all of your data and you won't lose any of your files. That does mean that for this 2-bay NAS, you are only able to make use of 1 drive's worth of space. So if you buy a 4 terabyte hard drive, or ideally 2 of the same, then you will only have 4 terabytes of usable space, as the other 4 terabyte drive is effectively acting as a backup. RAID is not a backup, but it's adding redundancy to your drives so that, again, if one fails, you don't lose your data. Technically speaking, you can also run what's called RAID 0 on this NAS, or really any RAID capable device, but RAID 0 is a really, really bad idea. Like, seriously awful, and I cannot recommend not using it enough. The reason for that is that instead of like RAID 1, where it's mirroring your data to both of the drives, RAID 0 does what's called striping. Basically, it chops up your file into a load of little pieces and then randomly stores those little pieces on across both drives. So you do get the benefit of effectively using all of the space that you put in. So again, in our example, if you buy 2 4-terabyte hard drives, you would get 8 terabytes of space, and you actually get a performance benefit because you're writing to both drives simultaneously with different data rather than writing effectively just to one, but writing to both or writing copies to both. But the trouble is, if either of those drives fail, have an error, or the RAID array itself just gets corrupted, then you lose all of your data. Now, there are a number of other RAID modes that you can use, but the catch is they all require more than 2 drives. That's where these 4-bay NAS units come in, and is one of the key benefits of getting a physically larger NAS. For example, you can use RAID 5, which requires 3 drives, and effectively works in a similar way to RAID 0, where it stripes your data across the drives, but it also writes what's called a parity block. The parity block is a checksum, it's a signature that you can use some math to generate, and then if one of your drives were to fail, then you can effectively use the same maths with that parity block to recreate the data that has gone missing in your failed drive. That does mean that you lose 1 drive worth of capacity, although I should make it clear that there isn't a single parity drive with RAID 5. It splits the parity bits across all of the devices or all of the disks, but you can lose 1 drive at a time and not lose any data. There is a slight asterisk in that rebuilding specifically a RAID array is a very intensive process and is known to kill the existing drives while rebuilding. So that's why RAID is not a backup. You should still back up your data to a second location. But again, it gives you both more capacity, as you can then have, for example, if you have all four bays populated here, you can have one drive worth of data as your parity, but then three drives full of full capacity you can write to just fine. And you even get a performance benefit as it's still striping the data across multiple drives. You can also run RAID 6, which is pretty much RAID 5, but writes two parity blocks instead of one, which means that you can lose up to two drives at any time and not lose any of your data. But the catch is that at least in this 4-bay NAS, well, you're losing two of your drives worth of capacity as well. So it's very similar in terms of RAID 1 to its overall use case for you. But that's where RAID 10 comes in. RAID 10 is what's called a nested RAID. It's not a direct feature. It's where you take two of the drives in your NAS and put them in a RAID 0 array. You take the other two and put them in a separate RAID 0 array. And then you use RAID 1 between both of those RAID 0 arrays. What that means is that you still cut your storage in half, or your usable storage in half, but you get some performance benefit from writing to two drives at a time. And if one of the drives were to fail, you still have both a full copy of all of your data on the other side of the RAID 1, but you also only have to read from that side of the array to rebuild the new or the other side. You don't have to read from every single drive. Now, the catch is RAID 5 would give you more capacity, but like I said, if a drive fails, RAID 10 is, at least in theory, a bit more safe to rebuild from. All of these fancier storage features are only going to be available to the 4-bay NAS users, and there's possibly a more obvious benefit, which is that you can just fit more disks in this 4-bay unit. Of course, the fact that there are now 16 and 18 terabyte hard drives that you can fit in even this 2-bay, for the majority of people, that's going to be plenty of storage. But if you want some added, well, physical space, and of course, the added benefit of being able to run, say, RAID 5 instead, and therefore get even more still redundant space out of this 4-bay, that's definitely a benefit. There's also the other sort of slight, I guess, future-proofing benefit where, at least in theory, if you were to, say, buy two or three drives, or specifically three, and build a RAID 5 array, you could then buy another of the same drives later on when you need more storage and incorporate that into your array and be able to expand that. Or even if you want to use a spare slot for, say, an SSD cache, that's also something that you should be able to do with a 4-bay unit, whereas on the 2-bay, unless it specifically supports it as an extra feature, there's just not enough bays for you to do that directly. Now, I mentioned SSD caching there, and I want to give you a quick explanation. Basically, imagine we have three drives in this 4-bay NAS running as a RAID 5 array. It's relatively quick, but especially the access time for reading things, or even just if you want to write a whole load of data at once and nice and fast, well, it's not ideal. So you can plug in a little SSD, a SATA SSD like this one, and effectively just stick it in one of the drive bays, enable the SSD caching, and then any files that you write to the NAS will first get written to this. This is much, much faster to write to and to read from, and so you can write as fast as you like to this, and then the NAS itself can slowly take all of the data that's in here and put it into the hard disk array in its own time. That lets you write a whole load of stuff at once as fast as basically your network can handle, and then the hard drives can slowly filter all of the data back in and into the protected array. You can also use this as a read cache in some devices, where your most commonly accessed files will get put on here instead, or at least a copy of them, and that means that you can access them insanely quickly and read at insanely fast rates for those most commonly accessed files. The main advantage of the two Bay NAS is mostly in its price, especially when you're comparing a direct apples to apples 2 versus 4 Bay model. The 2 Bay is pretty much always going to be cheaper. It's a physically smaller and effectively less feature-rich device, and so it's going to be priced less than its 4 Bay counterpart. And the even better thing is that you can often find a 2 Bay NAS that's a bit more expensive, maybe closer to the price of a 4 Bay NAS instead, but that has a whole load more features. It might have things like a faster CPU or more memory or upgradability in terms of its memory, in terms of its even having things like PCIe slots can be a great sort of value add and a very nice extra feature that all cost the same as even this relatively budget 4 Bay unit. I've actually had a couple of 2 Bay NASes that come with PCIe slots up at the top, which means that you can put add-in cards like the QNAP QM2 card I had in, which was not only a 10 gigabit Ethernet card, but it also had 2 M.2 SSDs on it to act as an insanely fast, like ludicrously fast SSD cache. Those sorts of added features are something that, again, for that lower price point, The NASes themselves that had those slots, they weren't all that more expensive, or even weren't more expensive than this budget 4 Bay units, and yet offered a much faster CPU, much more processing power, more RAM, and obviously having that PCIe slot is a pretty big feature. I do want to quickly note a couple of extra feature differences that you might want to just keep in mind when looking or shopping for a NAS for yourself. You want to look at things like the Ethernet speed. Most NASes that you'll find will run at 1 gig, which is probably what your home or, you know, office network runs at, although there are some that come with 2.5 gig, like both of these relatively budget units, but you can also find 5 gig and even 10 gig built into some, or like I said, you can even buy add-in cards for some NASes to add things like 10 gigabit Ethernet support. That's something that you will need to support both from the NAS, but also from your network, either from a switch or a router that supports that speed, and ideally a number of devices that also support that speed as well, with the caveat that if you're planning on having your NAS have a load of different users, then it's fine to have all of the users run at, say, 1 gig, but have a 10 gig port on the NAS and to your switch and router so that you can have as much bandwidth going to each individual user simultaneously rather than to a single individual user like me editing from my NAS, for example. You can also keep an eye out for other added features like the PCIe slots or upgradable RAM, which is quite handy to have, extra USB ports and physical copy or clone buttons that let you plug in a USB drive and clone whatever's on them to your NAS. That's quite handy. You can also find things like physical displays on the front of the unit to show you little status messages and the IP address of the NAS, or display outputs to let you use your NAS as a sort of home media center, like a smart TV, think a Roku or Chromecast type thing, or even something like an M.2 slot to let you do SSD caching, but without having to take up one of your 3.5 inch bays. So who should buy a 2 Bay NAS? Well, as a sweeping generalization, I would argue that the majority of home users will probably be fine with one of these. If you don't need more than 16 or 18 terabytes of total storage space, then this is probably fine. If you're a bit more of a power user, you might also prefer to go this route if you're still on a budget, as like I said, you can generally spend the same sort of money you would spend on a budget 4 Bay NAS on a more high-end 2 Bay and get a lot more features, a lot more power and that sort of thing from that, the same price. price points. And generally speaking, if you're, you know, just wanting to have a local backup of your family photos and documents and videos, or even run something like a, or store your Blu-ray collection, have it stream around the house with something like Plex, then again, a 2-bay NAS is probably just fine. And what about a 4-bay? Well, that's generally going to be someone who's a bit more of a power user, who needs more storage space, or potentially something like a bit more security in your data with RAID 5 or 6 or 10, for example. Or you want potentially a more high-end NAS with maybe more features. You are generally more likely to find upgradability in 4-bay NAS units, admittedly with a lot, you know, higher price tags, but again, that may be something that you're interested in. It's probably worth noting there are other options. Even in these pre-built enclosure style NASes, you can buy them anywhere from 1-bay, which I really don't recommend, all the way up to 9 or 10 bays, and that's assuming that you don't want to go and buy a rack mount server style chassis, in which case, well, you can basically put as many as you like in there. You can also DIY a solution. In fact, I've done that myself a couple of times, and I'm running my Overkill NAS, which is the one I built myself, and is the one that I now edit all of these videos from, which is fantastic. But that generally does require a higher level of technical proficiency than just shoving a couple drives in a box and turning it on. If you are willing to, say, build a PC, or even better, use an existing PC you already have laying around, then just chucking a couple of drives in it, ideally still the same drives, and running something like Unraid or TrueNAS or FreeNAS, the same thing but different name, then that's a great way to both make use of old hardware and not make it e-waste, but also give yourself some network attached storage. So I hope that is a bit of a clarification for anyone who's looking for a NAS themselves. If you have any questions, feel free to leave those in the comments down below. I'll be leaving links to both of these ASUSTOR NASes in the description down below for you to check out. Those are Amazon affiliate links that will take you to your local Amazon store. We can see pricing when and where you watch this, because it can and does vary. And on the end cards, when they pop up, I'll leave the review of both of these so you can check them out as well. Otherwise, that is kind of it for this video. If you want to see more videos like this one on a Monday, Wednesday, and Friday basis, mostly covering gaming PC hardware, but occasionally stepping into the storage side as well, then check out that subscribe button with the bell notification icon. If you want to support this channel and keep me making these videos, you can do that in a whole load of ways, from directly supporting through the YouTube join button, becoming a YouTube member, and getting access to our Money Mid Discord chat, sponsor-free videos, and some cool emojis to use in the comments and on our weekly live streams. Or you can support on Patreon instead, if you'd prefer. You can also pick up hoodies or t-shirts like this one, or a load of different designs I designed myself. There's other affiliate links in the description for places like Overclock GK if you're buying from there, or a load of different stuff, so feel free to check it out. And like I said, there'll be plenty of other videos on the end cards for you to take a look at as well. So yeah, hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for watching. We'll see you all in the next video.